वसुदेवसुदं देवं गंसचानूरमर्दनं देवगी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुम्।
Fourth chapter of the Gita starts with a beautiful sloka. Imam vivasvate yogam proktavanaham avyayam vivasvan manave praham manurikshvagam apravit. Imam vivasvate yogam प्रोक्तवानहम अव्ययम् विवस्ववान् मनवे प्राहम् मनुरिक्ष्वाग विप्रवीत्। The translation goes, Lord Sri Krishna says, I instructed this imperishable science of yoga to the sun god Vivasvan, and Vivasvan instructed it to Manu, the father of mankind, and Manu in turn instructed it to Ishvagu. We need to understand, Krishna is just 32 years old when he gives this statement. He is just 32 years old. Physically, his body is only 32 years old. But he says, I gave this knowledge to Surya, to sun god. Of course, very difficult to understand. With logic, you cannot understand this statement. With ordinary logic, which you are using in your daily life, you cannot make any meaning out of the statement. And he goes on. The next statement says, evam parampara praptamimam rajarshayo viduhu sakale neha mahata yogo nashta parantapaha. The supreme science was thus received through the chain of disciplic succession, and the saintly kings understood it in that way. But in course of time, the succession was broken, and therefore the science as it appears to be lost. The science as it is appears to be lost. These two slokas should be understood. First thing, the truth is not new. It is eternal. It is neither new nor old. It is eternal. Eternal means it is there forever. It never becomes old. It is never new. Eternal means beyond time. Anything which can be described based on the time, only those things can be said as new or old. Anything new will become old one day. Anything old was new at some day. Eternal means it is beyond new and old. It is there from time immemorial, but it has never become old. That is what meant by the word eternal. Here, this science of enlightenment is eternal, nitya. It is neither new nor old. The science which we learnt yesterday, or the science which he is going to explain further. Yesterday he gave the first glimpse, the first thing to be understood. That's the first glimpse. If you allow those words to penetrate you, if you open yourself to those words, straight away those words can give you the first glimpse of enlightenment. They can lead you to the first step of ultimate liberation. Understanding the purposelessness of life, all the stress, pressure, load, whether it is physical or mental, will be taken away from your being. You are liberated in that same moment. Krishna doesn't give you any technique which will work in course of time. In course of time. There are techniques which works in course of time. You will continue to practice, practice, practice. Maybe your son or your grandson will have the result. No. He says, now here or nowhere. Whether you have the result now here or nowhere. All these techniques straight away gives you the experience. If you can allow that one idea of purposelessness, the beauty of purposelessness into your consciousness, in that very moment, the breeze of enlightenment will happen to your heart. That very moment, the healing of your being will start. Healing of Bhavaroga, healing of the Samsara Roga, the birth and death disease will start its process. He says, 5,000 years ago, I gave this science to Surya, to the sun god, and the sun god instructed to Vivaswan, and sun god instructed to Manu. Sun god is Vivaswan. He instructed to Manu. Manu instructed the same thing to Ishvagu. He gives the disciplic succession. He gives that parampara, that Guru Shishya parampara. In course of time, Yogo Nashta Parantava, this science is lost. You should understand why this science is lost. When a disciple who listens, if he is not sincere, if he is not completely ready, naturally the technique becomes ritual. Understand, there is only one difference between technique and ritual. When it is done sincerely, even ordinary ritual will become a great meditation technique which leads you to enlightenment. When it is done without sincerity, as a routine, without understanding, as a routine, even a meditation technique will become a ritual. The only difference between meditation technique and ritual is sincerity, nothing else. It is just the sincerity. In course of time, the science is lost. Here's a beautiful word. The supreme science was taught, the supreme science was delivered you don't lose that supreme science just in one generation. In one generation it never gets lost. In course of time, somebody or other even a single unenlightened disciple is enough to destroy the whole science. Even a single person in the chain is enough to break the disciplic succession. A small story in Zen Buddhism. A disciple of a great master. He is sitting and talking about Zen to his followers. One enlightened master comes to him and asks, "You yourself have not become enlightened. What right you have to teach Zen?" This disciple, out of ego, the big problem is, when your master creates a big movement, and if you come to his seat without having the qualification, you are the most dangerous person. I have seen the people who just come into the throne as a successor, they are the most dangerous people. They will have everything except enlightenment. Person who creates a movement, he will create only out of energy and enlightenment. If he doesn't have, no movement will be created around him. But the person who succeeds, for him, it's just a gift. The whole movement is gift. He has got a complete infrastructure set up, but he doesn't have anything to share. Person who writes just because he's a writer is a dangerous person. Person who writes because he has got something to write, that's okay. Only he can be called as writer. Small story. One guy said, "Only after writing 5 bestsellers, I realized I don't know anything." Friend asked, "Then did you stop writing?" "No, by then I have become too famous, I can't stop." When you get somebody's throne as a successor, they will be filled with ego. They have everything except enlightenment. I always tell people, never go to the successors. Because the whole setup is created by somebody and they just represent. They don't have something from their experience. They are good librarians, but not masters. We must be very clear between the difference between librarians and masters. Librarians are good. They preserve the books, but they can only preserve the books, not more than that. This person is also a good librarian, good parent. He can repeat the whole thing. He is out of ego, says, "Don't you know I am the disciple of that great master?" This Zen master laughs. He just laughs and says, "If you wash the cup in which you kept the tea, will that water have the same taste of the tea?" Can you say the water which is used to wash the cup of the cup in which the tea is kept is equivalent to tea? How much of relationship will be there between the tea and the water which is used to wash the cup of the tea? For example, in one cup tea is there, in the other cup, the empty tea cup has been washed, that water is kept. What will be the relationship between the cup of the tea and the water which is used to wash the cup of the tea? There will be no relationship. Hardly you may have the smell of the tea in the water. So, if a person is not enlightened and just a successor, he will be dangerous. He will be dangerous. He will carry just the book, not the knowledge. That is why Zen masters they always destroy their books when they leave the body. Before they leave the body, they destroy the books. They say, if you have got the Zen in your life, if you have achieved the enlightenment, let you teach. Otherwise, keep quiet. At least you will not disturb the society. At least you will not create more trouble in the society. When you do something, if you are a successor without experience, you are the most dangerous person. A small story. In South India, there was a big mutt, or a traditional monastery, where every day the worship of Shiva is conducted. That master had a pet cat. He used to love animals, so he had a cat with him. The cat is so near to him, it will come and disturb when he does puja. When he does puja, it will come and jump on him, it will run around him. So he told his disciples, just cover the cat with a basket before I start the puja. They caught the cat, covered the cat with a basket, the puja started. Every day before he starts the puja, they will catch the cat, it will be covered with the basket, the puja will start, the worship will start. After some time, it has almost become a ritual. Before starting the puja, even if the cat is not inside the ashram, they started searching the cat. Even if the cat has gone outside for its walk, they go search the cat, they catch the cat and bring it and cover it and start the puja. After covering the cat, they start the puja. In course of time, the master passed away. He passed away. Now the disciples are in a very big trouble. What to do? Who will do the puja? Next puja. Anyhow, the next successor came. Because master passed away, the cat also ran away from the ashram, monastery. The cat did not get a good treatment, so it ran away. The next successor, before starting the puja, he called the disciples. What happened to the cat? Unless you get a cat, how can we start the puja? They went in search of a cat all over the city. Finally, somehow they got one cat, brought the cat, covered it with a basket, then puja started. After a few months, it has become very difficult to catch cats. Where to get the cats? And they said, Master, it is very difficult. It is very difficult to get cats. Please, you have to do something. The disciple said, all right, if there is no cat, then how can I do puja? Let us stop the puja. In course of the time, finally, because there is no cat, they stopped the puja. If you are not enlightened, this is what happens. If a disciple is not enlightened, this is what happens. The truth is lost. The spirit is lost. If you want to destroy any law, all you need to do is just follow the letter, miss the spirit. That's enough. If you just follow the letter, forget about the spirit, that's enough. You will do exactly opposite to the law. What for the law is created, you will just go against it. In course of time, the people who have not become enlightened, who are not sincere, they entered into this field and corrupted the science. Because of that, the sciences lost. That is why again and again and again our Upanishad insists, go to a living master. All our books are only manuals. Vedas are the only books which are courage to declare, we cannot give you enlightenment. Vedas are the only books which are courageous enough to declare, we are not ultimate. They say very clearly, we are only the manuals. If you want the ultimate reference, go to a living master. All the medical books, in the end what they will say? Consult your family doctor. They will end with one line. All these things are only manuals. You can't take medicines just by reading a medical book. You can't take medicines from a person who is not a doctor. In India, compounders, the doctor's assistants, by and by, after some time, they learn the trade of the trick of the trade. By now they know headache means yellow tablet, stomach pain, green tablet, and back pain, black tablet. They know the color of the tablet for particular disease. If you go and take medicine from compounder, sometime you may get healed, you may get the cure, but it is very dangerous. It is very dangerous. Taking medicine from compounder, learning from unenlightened master is one and the same. Going to unenlightened person and taking medicine from compounder is one and the same. Please be very clear. Compounder, at the most, he may destroy your one body, your one life. But unenlightened master will destroy your lives after lives. He can destroy, misguide you. He can create trouble for lives after lives. Because even a single point, if it is lost, if you have missed, the whole thing is lost.